Thank you very much. With Michael Bloomberg Sugar Police not here, I had my three Snickers, so I'm ready to go. Thank you. You know, when I look at the topic today of From Gold to Dust, it sort of reminds me of one of the classic books I read long ago, Atlas Shrugged. Should Atlas and California shrug and wait for everything to go downhill, kind of the sinking of the Titanic? Is that the only way to recover, or can we in an incremental way do so? We had the closest thing we had to Atlas was Schwarzenegger, and that was a dismal failure. And, you know, I'm going to take a trip back down memory lane. Larry has asked me to provide a context for the panel historically. There's lots that could be said, but in the short time, I'd like to note some of the failures, not to be negative, but because they're instructive and hopefully we can learn from them. Remember, Schwarzenegger kind of gave us a clue to just what an empty suit he was when he proposed, before being governor, a successful initiative campaign to mandate a $500 million expenditure for after-school programs when we weren't even able to teach our kids the basics. So we kind of had a clue. But, you know, my polling back then showed that Californians felt we were in a crisis. And we had a new Republican governor who had a captive audience and public sentiment that would have provided institutional reform for pensions and other things. Within 60 days, he sold away the store. So we have to look at the missed opportunities that we have had in this state. Let's go back to my early involvement in politics. I can remember a day, and I've spoken to some of you here who are not native Californians. Those who have lived here for some decades, those who were, may forget just the way the old days were. You know, when I was a young boy and went to the convention center here, actually the sports arena, and then the Coliseum here, John F. Kennedy give his inaugural speech, I was attracted by themes that now turn out to be Republican and conservative. Strong anti-communism, strong national defense, innate patriotism. We had a missile gap, I was told, and the Republicans were responsible for it. We had a do-nothing president who played golf, Eisenhower. Kennedy, of course, would play more golf. And within a few years of reading and becoming energized, I looked toward Republicans. And in those days, LA County was a Republican power source. I can tell you that when I took the bus, I wasn't able to drive at my young age of preteen, and went to the Republican Party headquarters on 6th Street near Alvarado, next to the then small FBI headquarters there. The county Republican Party had a budget that was larger than virtually any state Republican Party in the United States. When Ronald Reagan ran for governor in 1966, LA County was such a Republican bastion, they required 7 field directors dividing LA County into 7 different regions as if it were a state. I can remember in 1964, there was a ballot proposition called Proposition 14 that was an effort to overturn what was called the Rumford Fair Housing Act. Proposition 14 was an assertion of property rights. It was flawed and declared unconstitutional. But Proposition 14 passed in the same year that Lyndon Johnson carried the state by a landslide. Now, we just had some speakers here talk about the recent election and Trump and so on. Can you imagine Trump losing the state by as much as he did and a Republican that year winning? George Murphy won conclusively for United States Senator in 1964, the same year that Barry Goldwater lost this state by a landslide. That was a true ticket splitter environment we don't have anymore, and we have to live and adapt into a new kind of environment. You want to know what kind of environment it was back then? I can remember as a young boy, as a teenager, going to George Murphy's news conference, and reporters all said, "Now, how are you going to vote on Proposition 14? That was a dominant ballot initiative that year. And here's what George Murphy got away with. He went back, and he went back away from the podium. I can't quite imitate him, or you won't be able to hear me, but he had been an actor, you may recall, with Shirley Temple in the movies, a dancer. And he said, "I can't believe you're asking me that question. Do you know that we have had American soldiers die for the precious right you're asking me to abrogate, the right to go into a ballot box and to vote in privacy. And you're asking me to tell you how I would vote." Well, that's the kind of effective candidates we had, the kind of era we had there. Ronald Reagan then told State Senator Clark Bradley after George Murphy won, fellow actor, he said, you know, if George can do it, I can run for governor there. And that's what happened a couple of years later. This was an era where Nelson Rockefeller was on the verge of winning the presidential primary in California. That would have been a big step toward getting him the nomination, and lost because he was divorced. Now, of course, Ronald Reagan was divorced years later. That's how much the political environment has changed. And in 1964, we had that Proposition 14 on the ballot. Do you know who editorialized for it strongly? The Los Angeles Times. Now, the Los Angeles Times then was as much a journalistic prostitute as it still is. It was because it feared its loss of advertising lineage for apartment listings there. But again, it shows you the different kind of environment. Those were the times when a Republican was mayor of San Francisco, George Christopher. Now, we have three elements that we need for political success. We need a candidate, and we need a campaign, and we need ideas. We need all three, and sometimes we have not had all three together. We've had two or one of them, and we've lost there. So when I look back at Max Rafferty, who was a wonderful person in 1968, he lost not so much because of the year per se, but because he projected a kind of an anger and a standoffishness that did not serve him well. So we got Alan Cranston every 6 years, again and again and again. I can remember a year in 1986 when a client of mine, Bobby Fiedler, who had been elected to defeat Jim Corman, who would have been the Democratic chairman of Ways and Means in the East San Fernando Valley, a district that was 62% Democrat, 31% Republican, and demographically was an awful district from our standpoint. She won and likely would have defeated Alan Cranston there. She was a woman candidate at least 6 years ahead of the so-called Year of the Woman in 1982 when both Boxer and Feinstein won. Why did she lose? Because we had an iconoclastic, and that's a generous word, Ed Davis, law and order type, who came from that era among Republicans that no longer exist. In those days, a lot of the law and order folks were professionals that put policy ahead of pension benefits. And now the so-called law and order community is very much linked with Democrats who are not necessarily in accord with their policy, but are saying, you know, you can retire at 50 with a certain kind of a pension. And so Ed Davis was involved in a dirty trick where he wound up causing Bobby Fiedler to be indicted, and her campaign was disabled, and then we went to lose to Alan Cranston. So we suffer from a lot of errors in the past there. This is a conference in part to energize the base, but make no mistake about it. In order to go forth here, you have to, the last panel ended with what ought you to do, and one of the things you ought to do is to say, does what I'm about to do merely energize the base, or does it reach somebody new? And there simply is a base far too narrow in this state that even if you energized it entirely and you increased the voter propensity from people in this room from 97% to 99%, it would make a marginal difference because we're not narrowly losing elections. We're losing elections in a big kind of a way there. We have a situation now where partly through bad efforts, ill-advised efforts by some of our own people, we have come up with a situation of term limits that we thought was a panacea that has empowered the bureaucrats in Sacramento because they stay and some of our people go in and go out there. The lobbyists stay. They don't have any kind of a term limit. And so what the term limits have accomplished, we thought it was going to be throwing out the rascals. It's wound up when the rascal's term limit ends, his or her chief staff member comes in and assumes the office, or they go from assembly to senate to county supervisor. This open primary is a disaster there, and we should have gotten and still should get open government types, even some liberals who see it as bad kind of government. What we have to do right now to change the equation in California is we have to go toward the culture and beyond politics that shapes the political environment, because elections are not really, at this point, the cause of our problems, they're the consequence of our problems. And so we have an incestuous relationship between the people who are running for nonpartisan office, the school board, county supervisor, city councils here, that are in effect in the training ground to run for partisan office, and they're using government funds to solidify. We need to take an entire reformist approach. Let's eliminate all the press secretaries for all elected officials. Let's start taking their names off the signs there. And you know, even as awful as Los Angeles Times is, we now are in an environment where the Democrats are in control. So wouldn't you like to have investigative reporting against incumbents, since most of the bad people are Democrats? Wouldn't you like to have a newspaper that has even taken on pension reforms? As awful as it is, as left-wing as it is, do away with that, and you're going to be protecting the incumbents, and they're mainly Democrats and mainly liberals. So we really have to take a very original, different kind of look as we go forward at this particular stage. The book that I've done is trying to trace in part the political history of California and to learn from it and to look at that intersection of people and policy and ideas to try to move ahead from this point on. I look forward to the panel discussion. Thank you.